So we are going to start with the chapter of federalism. Before this, we had a revision of power sharing. Now, what is power sharing? That was, we have studied the two cases, one of Belgium and the second of Sri Lanka. In case of Belgium, we find regional accommodation to be there. Now, what is going to happen if regional accommodation is not there? Then ultimately we will find civil war to be there, as it was in the case of Sri Lanka, and ultimately in future the country is going to disintegrate. So regional accommodation is utmost necessary, or we can say that power sharing is a true spirit of a democracy. So in 1993, after the amendment in the constitution of Belgium, it became federal. That is, we can say that Belgium was the country to be shifting from unitary to federal form of government. Now, if I talk about Sri Lanka, that continues to be, for all practical purpose, a unitary system. Why? Because a national government has all the parts, and the rest, if they are there, they are subordinate to national government. If you remember about Tamil people, they were the one to ask for independent state because they were being disregarded. Their culture, their language, everything was disregarded. So they wanted Sri Lanka to become a federal system. So what is federalism? So federalism is a system of a government in which the power is divided between the authority and various constituent units. Federalism, it is what? It is a system of a government where the power is divided between the central government and the state government. Now, in some countries, there might be three tiers of the government. In some countries, there are two tiers. So if there are three tiers, then we find the division of the power to be there in three tiers. So this is vertical division of the power among different levels of the government. Children, do you remember horizontal division? It is legislature, executive, and judiciary. So federalism, we can say it is one of the major forms of power sharing in modern democracies. Because power sharing, that is a basic concept or the base of democracy. And democracy means for the people, by the people, to the people. So similarly, federalism, what is it? It is one of the major forms of power sharing in the modern democracy. Modern democracy, that is representative form of democracy. Now let us talk about features, key features of federalism. What does it say? There are mainly seven key features of federalism, and we need to know about them and we need to learn. It's very important question. Before I go with it, let us talk about unitary government and federal government. If the unitary system is there, that is only one tier of the government is there, or subunits are there which are subordinate to the central government, where the whole soul power is with particular central government, then that kind of government is said to be having a unitary system. Here the central government can only pass the laws to the provincial or the local government. Like in federal system, what happens in federal system? The central government is not going to give any kind of order to the state government. The state government has its own powers, and it is not answerable to central. That is, it is not subordinate to central government. Now let us look at the key features, because this is a very important question and you need to know. If it is a federal country or the federal system is found to be existing in a country, there are always two or more levels of the government. That is said to be tiers of the government: central government, state government, local government. Now, if I talk about the different levels of the government that I've already told you now, you live in a country, we all live in a country. So either it be the central government or the state government or the local government, they are all ruling the same citizens. That is, different levels of the government rule the same citizens, whereas each level has its own jurisdiction. Now, if you think about different levels of the government, they have their own laws. They follow their own jurisdiction, that is law. But they are found to be ruling the same citizens. Now, this jurisdiction may be related to legislation, may be related to taxation, may be related to administration. Now, the third point, existence and authority of each level of the government is constitutionally governed. Anything becomes a law if it is written in constitution. So the existence of the state government and the authority that it can move as per its own desire, it is not subordinate or answerable to the central government, that is constitutionally guaranteed. It is written in the constitution. So existence and authority of each level of the government is constitutionally governed. You are not going to govern yourself. If you are trying to govern yourself, that is, you will overrule. Hum overrule karne ki koshish karenge, lekin aisa nahi ho sakta. Kyun? Kyunki ye constitutionally governed hai. It is written. Number four, the fundamental provisions of the constitution cannot be unilaterally changed. Now, when there are three tiers of the government, so can central government change the law by itself? No. It cannot change the laws by itself, that is unilaterally. Unilaterally, that is single-handedly, it cannot change anything. If the laws are going to change or they require a change, then you need the consent of the state as well as the central government. Let's proceed. We have come to point number five, that is, the courts have the power to interpret the constitution. I said you that in India, the judiciary is found to be at the top. It is free. So the court has the power to interpret the constitution. If any changes are required, then the court is the one to interpret the constitution. And there are three courts mainly out of that. That is the highest court. That is the Supreme Court is the one which acts as an umpire. So just like in a game where there is an umpire and umpire is the one to give a decision whether the batsman is out or not. I'm talking about cricket. Similarly, here Supreme Court acts as an umpire, and if any dispute is found to be arising between the different levels of the government, then it is the one to solve it. And both the governments, either the central or the state, they will have to follow the decision of the Supreme Court. So in any case, the decision of the Supreme Court is said to be final. Now, sources of revenue for each level of the government are specified to ensure its financial autonomy. We know very well that every government is going to run through money. They need some financial resources. Now, for these financial resources, what are we to do? How are they going to get states? They are going to earn in the form of tax. Now, if all the taxes are to be paid to the central and then given to the state, then ultimately state is going to be subordinate and it will not be a federal country. So in our constitution, it is clearly written that the sources of the revenue or the tax for each level of the government are specified, that which tax is going to go to state government and which revenue is going to go to central government. Right? So this is how the finance or the financial autonomy of the particular tier of the government is being maintained. Number seven, federal system is having dual objectives. It is having dual objective. Number one, it safeguards and promotes the unity of the country. It safeguards and promotes the unity of the country. Secondly, It is the one to accommodate regional diversity. We know very well that India is a diversified country. And if we are now going to accommodate diversification, then it is going to disintegrate. So ultimately, we need to respect each and every culture, each and every religion. And as a result, that is what the federal system says about. Thank you.